working on my sound was deliberate, and I did spend a lot of time trying to sound like my heroes, the masters, various people, quite a few of them actually. And I was pretty detailed about it, even to the extent of changing my setup to some extent during certain periods when I was involved with certain players. For example, at one point I was really into Joe Henderson, so I played a Mark VI, and I played a Selmer Solos D for a while, and then I played an E for a while, short shank, and then a long shank later on when I saw him playing one in the 70s, so I tried that one too. This was back in maybe like 1990, 91, and then other people too. So yes, I spent a lot of time on that, and sound-wise, also long tones in that, but I spent time with sound from, I had one of my teachers taught me basically to think about long tones in terms of, or your sound in terms of how your fingers connect to each other, meaning most of the time we are, you know, when you're playing, you're not playing long tones all the time. You're usually trying to get your sound while you're moving note to note. So much of the trick is trying to not let air escape between your fingers and trying to keep your sound basically so it sounds like one note, no matter how many notes you're playing, how fast you're playing, how large the intervals are. So there are many other things too, for example, putting your sound in a place. So for example, trying to put your sound just in front of you, like 4 to 6 feet, kind of like in a round ball. Also focusing your sound maybe to the back of the room to a very, very small point if you have a large enough room to do it. And also maybe trying to put your sound kind of in a midpoint between you and the back of the room. So you kind of want to put your sound somewhere as well. That's it. So Lenny Tristano, Warren Marsh, the Konitz, influenced my playing in the sense that, well, there's a lot to it, but I'll keep it short. One is just the improvisational nature of their playing, especially Warren. He very rarely repeats himself, you know, just kind of being able to improvise and kind of make, have that intensity, at least for me, it sounds like that kind of feel on the seat of your pants without using any drum. It's all content, and it always sounds like he's about to fall over in terms of not knowing what he's going to play, but actually usually he always makes it. So that's one aspect. The other is just the melodic linear aspect. Very interesting, a lot of passing tones, and using altissimo in a very even manner. The other thing is when I first started listening to he and that school of playing is I was trying to find, maybe some people that improvised in a way that felt very organic, for lack of a better word, but was still coming out of the same kind of area or tradition as bebop. That same type of era, same kind of harmony, same kind of songs played over. So that's kind of the short of it, yeah. Yam Yam was my maternal grandfather. I called him that because he called me the Yam Yam Man when I was a toddler, and then hence I started calling him Yam Yam. And what does he mean to me? He's a huge influence on my life. I wouldn't say I patterned my life after him, but he was a very determined individual. He was president of Wilberforce University, which is a historically black college. And I think he was vice president of St. Clair College, and maybe another one too, I don't remember all of them. But he was an engineer, aeronautical engineer. He actually built planes, pilot. He trained pilots in World War II, for the first black pilots in World War II to fly and be involved in the Air Force. He was born to a working class family and died a multimillionaire. So he was a very highly educated, very rich man at the end of his life, and highly accomplished.